I welcome you all for this 10th lecture in Democracy Dialogue series. I'm Subhash Gatade, associated with New Socialist Initiative. We started this discussion, this series last year during the pandemic, and this is the 10th lecture. And the basic idea behind this whole lecture series has been to join the conversation around democracy, the challenges faced by democracy, how, on the one hand, democracy is deepening at various levels, and simultaneously we are getting bigots, we are getting fascist forces at the top. So our concern in this series has been to understand, to unpack this whole situation, and we feel that whether it can be understood only in political economic terms, or we need to look into the social civilization mindset also. Our guest this evening is Professor Mudula Mukherjee. He definitely doesn't need any introduction, but still, for all those people who he has been professor of modern Indian history at Center for Historical Studies in JNU. Then she was director at Nehru Memorial Library for a few years. She has been author of many books. She's well known as a historian for her work on the role of peasants in the Indian independence movement. And she has authored two important books on the theme: Peasants in India's Nonviolent Revolution and Colonizing Agriculture, Myth of Punjab Exceptionalism. Both the books have been brought out by Sage. And she has co-authored books with Professor Bipin Chandra, Professor Aditya Mukherjee, India's Struggle for Independence. On the last count, I could see that 4 lakh copies of this book has been sold. And India After Independence. Both the books have been brought out by Penguin. Her monograph with Professor Aditya Mukherjee and Professor Sujata Mahajan, RSS, School Text, and Murder of Mahatma Gandhi, has also been widely appreciated. Definitely, this is not an exhaustive list of her books. She has many other books to her credit. This evening, she will be enlightening us about nationalism, then and now. Basically, she will be looking at the genesis of nationalism, its evolution, and she intends to underline that the fact that the task of preventing appropriation of nationalism and its creative linking to progressive agenda is the need of the hour. There will be a question and answer session after her speech, and please enter your comments and questions in the chat box. If you're interested in getting further details of this dialogue series, please enter your contact details, also your phone number, as well as email address. Friends, please welcome Professor Mudula Mukherjee.
Thank you very much. Should I begin the talk now? Okay. Thank you. Well, friends, I'm really very grateful to the New Socialist Initiative. And I must say that having seen the list of previous speakers, I am sufficiently intimidated and nervous to speak before such a galaxy of people, and particularly, I mean it very seriously, people who have been very seriously engaged with the issues that are before us as a people today from a socialist perspective. And I really appreciate the fact that there is a very concerted attempt to open up to fresh ideas, to rethink the way we have been situated, maybe also some of the wrong paths we have taken in the past, some of the weaknesses in the socialist movement and socialist ideas in India, which are bound to be in any dynamic force, bound to have weaknesses as well as strengths. But I think situated where we are today, it's extremely important that we look at ourselves very critically, with great honesty, because the nature of the crisis that we are in today is of such enormous proportions that we cannot afford to be lazy or self-indulgent, because what is at stake is the future of a very large number of people. And therefore, it is imperative on us to give it our most honest, critical, based on deep thought and reflection, and of course, informed by whatever scholarship that we can muster. So with that, I would like to begin my discussion. I chose the theme of nationalism for two reasons. One, as Subhashji just said, because I think it is very important that we see how we can prevent its appropriation or misappropriation today, and how we can marry it, how we can link it to a progressive agenda. I think that's one of the crucial questions before us today, especially as people belonging to a socialist way of thinking. This, I think, has been one of the weaknesses. You know, how do we link it up? How do we creatively ally nationalism to our agendas? And the other reason is a more personal one. It's that I have been now engaged for many decades in the study of nationalism. I have taught it for many years at JNU till I retired, and also I've written on it, and it continues to be a subject of great personal interest to me and concern. And I also feel that the history of our freedom struggle, how nationalism was interpreted and creatively developed in India. It was not a copybook nationalism. We didn't just pick up from Europe and apply it here. What we call Indian nationalism was a very specific nationalism with its own attributes. And I don't think we understand it enough. I don't think we pay it enough attention, even though it was then an ideology which inspired and took forward one of the mightiest mass movements of world history, yet we have not paid it enough attention. So these are the reasons why I thought that I would talk today to you about nationalism then and now. So I'll begin the formal part of my talk now. I will first talk about, in a general sense, about the idea of nationalism. When and how and why, in what historical context, did this idea first emerge? How did nations emerge? And then I will come more specifically to the issue which concerns us today, about what is the nature of Indian nationalism in the past and in the present. Most scholars who have studied the phenomenon agree on one thing, that nationalism is a modern phenomenon. Even though it often harks back to the ancient past to buttress its claims, it is not something that was born in the remote past. You did not have the notion of nationalism or nations in the ancient past or in the medieval past. However, as nationalism emerges as an idea, and when nations begin to get formed, a process which first starts in Europe in the 17th and then continues in the 18th and 19th centuries, in the formation of those ideas, in the formation of those nations, they look back upon their past and go back to that past to find elements of continuity, of commonality, which may help to keep them together or bring them together or help in the crystallization of a national identity. That is why we tend to confuse these two. We are told that we were a nation in the hoary past. We are told that we were a nation in ancient India. We were a nation when the Buddha was around. We were a nation when the Guptas were there. But this is not true. What is true is that we can talk about the emergence in that period of pan-Indian empires. The Maurya king Ashoka was the earliest ruler who in India had close to a subcontinental empire. So if we are talking about some elements of political unification, we can even go back and look at the Mauryan Empire. But it would be very wrong if we said India was a nation under Ashoka, because being a nation is something very different from being part of an empire in the ancient world, because empire and nation are two very different phenomena. They are two distinct state forms. It is not just a question of political unity, which is imposed from above by a ruler or a ruling class or a ruling clan. Similarly, during the Gupta period, we again had rulers who conquered and unified large parts of the territory of the subcontinent. We can say again that with the Mughals, that happened. The Mughal Empire did cover large parts of what the subcontinent is, and yet we will not say that India was a nation under the Mughals. But the main point I want to make here is that the process of the evolution of modern nations, that in that process, when people hark back to history, they are harking back in order to look for certain symbols, certain cultural features, certain unifying forms. But it is not tantamount to saying that we were a nation in the past, ancient past. This is very important, particularly for us in India today, because we are often told this, how our Rashtra, you know, is a very old one. And the nation, we are even told, is as if the soul of the nation or its spirit has been suppressed for so many years. And now that spirit has to come into its own. But the nation was always there. This is not true. You may have some cultural commonness which emerges over the centuries. Even that cannot be the same, as you know, as, for example, what that cultural commonness could be, let's say, 300 years from now. What could be the points at which people could even get to know each other in the ancient past, when communications were poor, contact was poor, and unifying empires were also so few and came after many centuries. So we have to factor all that in when we are talking about the origins of nations. In Europe, the political process of the emergence of nations started in an embryonic way in the middle of the 17th century. Usually, it is accepted that it was with the Treaty of Westphalia in 1648 that this process started, because this treaty brought to an end a lot of conflict which had been going on. Very large number of nations came together, and the principle of national sovereignty was recognized for the first time. As these nations emerged, they started looking back at their histories to see if they could find some common features which could help ground their nationalism. Sometimes they found them, sometimes they did not. And different countries found different things. In Germany, for example, the notion of being a German nation was very much based on a form of romantic nationalism tied up with what they called folk culture. The notion was that the Germans were a people whose speciality was that they had a very strong folk culture. And this they saw as their distinctive national identity. How fascinating. Folk cultures are always localized. And yet that got adopted as a kind of hallmark of German nationalism. In some other countries, religion could be a unifying factor, which went along with the modern idea of nationalism. In France, for example, there was, of course, the French Revolution, with the notion that we believe in similar ideas, liberty, fraternity, equality. which very much went into the making of the modern French nation. But along with it somewhere, Catholicism was a solidifying factor. In Germany, similarly, Protestantism remained a solidifying factor. In Britain, we know how Britain under the Tudor King Henry VIII broke away from the Roman Catholic Church, adopted Protestantism, and that became a symbol of national sovereignty vis-a-vis the Roman Catholic Church. So Protestantism of a different kind, different from the German kind, became a hallmark of British national identity. But Britain was also the United Kingdom, which united the Scots, the English, and the Welsh. And British nationalism is thus constituted by these three very distinctive identities. Britain also retained the institution of the monarchy, albeit in a modified form as a constitutional monarchy. And the monarchy, in fact, became the symbol of modern British nationalism and unity, as did the monarchy in Japan. So we have the fascinating phenomenon of two neighboring nations with completely contrasting symbols of nationalism, the Republic in France and the monarchy in Britain. And mind you, both have served their purposes equally well or equally badly, depending on where you are situated. Republican France exhibited no more inhibitions as a colonial power than did monarchical Britain. The slogans of the revolution, liberty, equality, fraternity, proved no greater hindrance to the French acquiring and exploiting colonial territories across the world than did the Magna Carta to the British. So each country has its own specific history of how it emerges as a modern nation and how it then deals with other identities which are part of its history and part of its formation as a nation. For example, Eric Hobsbawm, who is one of the best historians of the modern age, emphasizes that each nation evolves differently. Nations are similar only in that they are nations. They are similar in that they have a feeling of nationalism. But what that nationalism is, the content, the contours of that nationalism, that is the content of being Indian, the flavor of being American, the taste of being French, is all very different. And it is different, why? Because your histories go into the evolution of that identity as a nation. You do not become a nation overnight. It is not that one day you wake up and say, I'm an Indian or I am French. It is a process. Sometimes it happens through a revolutionary process, like the French Revolution or the American Revolution. In our case, it happened primarily through our national revolution, that is, the anti-colonial movement for independence, our freedom struggle. Through that, we became a nation. It was primarily through that that we began to think ourselves as Indians, because that movement brought us all together to fight a common enemy. And in the process of fighting that common enemy, we started to discover more and more commonalities also about each other, which went beyond just the purpose of fighting together for freedom. We also then found common cultural attributes, and we discovered that we were, in fact, becoming Indians. In Europe, when nationalism emerged, it first emerged as a new political state formation to take the place of earlier empires. The process took about two centuries. It was initially very slow, but then it picked up in the 18th century and speeded up in the 19th. 1815 was a very important moment because with the French Revolution and the Napoleonic Wars, one consequence was that the old empires and the old kingdoms just crumbled. So lots of new nations came into being and could establish their independence. Again, the whole of the 19th century saw the process of the formation of nations. Italy, for example, and German unification were the two well-known ones. Again, it is important to remember that even within Europe, a fairly unified area, nation formation does not take place at the same time. But one thing I want to point out about the emergence of nations and nationalism in Europe was that almost right from the beginning, nationalism gets tied up with colonial agendas. Oliver Cromwell, having defeated Charles I, conquered Ireland in the name of the British Parliament almost immediately after the Treaty of Westphalia of 1648. And he let loose unspeakable atrocities on the Irish, which led to a drastic reduction of the population, by some estimates, by 40%. Lands of Catholics were seized, thousands made indentured laborers and sent to the West Indies. No Catholic worship was allowed. Hundreds of thousands died of plague. So as early as the 17th century, we find that even among the early imaginings of nationalism comes imperial conquest, colonial conquest. This speeds up in the 18th century. India, for example, is conquered from the middle of the 18th century onwards by the British. But even before that, the competition between the Dutch and the French and the English and the Portuguese for colonial possessions had started. So the nationalism that emerges in Europe has from the very beginning also an aggressive and aggrandizing aspect to it. This is extremely important for us to remember because it gives a particular quality to that nationalism. Of course, European nationalism also had a liberationist aspect, especially in the beginning, because it was against the empires. It was for the liberation of the smaller units. So in the beginning, it had both these characteristics, the revolutionary aspect, the liberation aspect, as well as the colonial, dominational, or aggressive aspect. But from the beginning of the 19th, but from the middle of the 19th century, you find the aggressive part begins to get stronger. Why? As more and more of the world had already been conquered and made into colonies, the ones outside Europe, by the European countries, those countries like Italy and Germany, for example, who were latecomers in the business of national unification and industrial development, as they became powerful, they too wanted a share of the colonial spoils. They also wanted captive markets for their products. So from about the 1870s, 1880s, the period, for example, when the scramble for Africa begins and then the partition of Africa, which happens by the end of the 19th century. You would all remember how the imperial powers actually sit down around a table and draw lines on a map to divide Africa among the European powers. Which is why if you look at the map of Africa, it has straight lines. Which cut across natural boundaries, which cut across geographies, which cut across ethnic identities. They neither respect the animals who cross those lines every year, nor the human animals, nor nature. So this also coincides with the new stage of imperialism, which we call the age of finance capital or the age of financial imperialism. And this is a very reactionary period of imperialism, far more reactionary than the early periods. So European nationalism, to again summarize, in the early years, for the first century and a half, had both these aspects, the liberationist as well as the reactionary. In the colonies, however, it's important to remember that from the beginning, European nationalism in the colonies only has the aggrandizing aspect and the aggressive aspect, which is only expressed in their own countries in the beginning. From the late 19th century onwards, it becomes more and more reactionary. And in the 20th century, we get its worst form. In Europe, nationalism takes the form, the most reactionary form of fascism and Nazism. That is also nationalism. We can never forget that. It is like a gradual progression. It is this extremely reactionary form which nationalism takes vis-a-vis the colonies, which then comes back to feed into the whole of European nationalism. It is precisely Italy and Germany, those who had felt that they had got left out of the race, where these phenomena emerge in a very big way. Fascism in Italy and Nazism in Germany. And we can never forget that both Mussolini and Hitler justified their policies and their politics and their ideologies in the name of nationalism. So nationalism can take on, has taken on in world history, a very reactionary aspect, which is why in the Western world, for example, after the Second World War, when people had been through the horrors of fascism, Nazism, and the Second World War, in which millions and millions of people lost their lives, the phenomenon or the word nationalism itself acquired a derogatory meaning. It became a dirty word. Even today, when as scholars in seminars, etc., we talk about nationalism, and we scholars coming from colonial countries, we talk about nationalism in a positive way. Scholars from Europe and the West and even Japan are very suspicious, because the progressive ones among them especially have looked upon nationalism in a very negative way, because they are looking at it from the experience of, from their own experience, what their countries went through. Now, coming to India, in the colonial countries, however, nationalism emerges as part and parcel of the movement for liberation from colonial rule. In the Indian case, on which I shall focus now, the emergence of the modern ideas of nationalism can be dated to the 1870s and 1880s. Do not think that the modern idea of nationalism had yet emerged in the revolt of 1857, though it was a national revolt against a colonial power. And even though we have some indications, especially from Maharashtra, from the native Indian press, of anti-colonial economic ideas emerging among the intelligentsia of that region. But in a fully developed kind of form, it's really from after the 1860s that we date the emergence of the ideas of nationalism. And first and foremost, they come in the Indian language press, or what was then called the vernacular press. People started writing and talking about the negative consequences of British rule, the necessity to change it, what kind of nation should we bring into being, what kind of modern nation should be brought into being. These nebulous ideas, first in a very rudimentary form, and then gradually in a more developed form, begin in the 1870s. Dadabhai Naroji's pioneering work also begins to come out around the same time, when he starts analyzing the economic effects of British rule on India and comes out with the theory of the drain of wealth, where he shows that the Indian economy had been subjugated to that of Great Britain and how there was a continuous drain of wealth that occurs from India to Britain. He's joined very soon by a galaxy of other leaders, for example, Ranade, Gokhale, Agarkar, R.C. Dutt, Subramaniam Iyer, and others, who then flesh out the whole theory of economic nationalism, on which then new ideas of political nationalism begin to be based. Economic nationalism, thus, in the Indian case, gave a solid grounding to Indian nationalism and protected it from straying into nativist or ethnic or cultural directions. from the 1870s and 1880s, we also have modern political organizations cropping up, first at the local and the provincial level, and then at the national level. And then by 1885, we have the Indian National Congress, which emerges out of the National Conference, and other similar organizations. Thus, by 1885, we have a unified national organization, which calls itself the Indian National Congress, each word of its name signifying something very important. The words Indian and national denote that there is an Indian nation, which it represents. And the term Congress, which is taken from the American Congress, means it is a parliament of the people. This also signifies that it is committed to a democratic form of government. I want to emphasize that the role of the first 30 to 40 years of intellectual endeavors by some of the best minds of India was very crucial in fleshing out what the nation should be, the basis on which it should be built. It was not just one Dadabhai Naoroji or one Gokhale or one Tilak. There was a galaxy of people of extraordinary ability who devoted their lives to this process. And it bears emphasis that the foundation of Indian nationalism was not just in the movement out in the streets. It was also very much an intellectual process in which, as I said, the best minds of different parts of the country participated. The first and the foremost thing that comes out of this process is that they all agreed that what they need to build is an Indian nation. Mind you, this was not an automatic conclusion. That they need to build an Indian nation and not a Bengali nation or a Tamil nation or a Maratha nation. If this is so, then obviously language could not be the unifying factor. No matter how much Lokmanya Tilak may love Marathi, which he did, no matter how great his command over it, which there was, no matter how great an orator he was in the Marathi language, he brought out two newspapers, Kesari and Maratha, one in Marathi and one in English. Similarly, almost all the famous leaders of the time, many of whom were very good journalists, were very good in their own languages and communicated with their regional audience in their own region, in their own languages. But simultaneously, they had a notion that they were building an Indian nation and a movement which was going to fight for independence, not for their province, not the independence of Bengal from colonial rule, not the independence of Mysore or Hyderabad from colonial rule, but independence for India. So obviously what was worked out then was that the Indian nation, as I just said, could not be based on a single language or religion. In a multi-religious country, how could it be? If it was based on a single religion, it could not then be Indian nationalism. It would either have to be Hindu nationalism or Sikh nationalism or Muslim nationalism. But the leaders of the freedom struggle were building an Indian nation. Therefore, just as region, language was ruled out, so was religion ruled out as the basis of Indian identity. Sri Aurobindo, who is sometimes claimed as an ancestor by the Hindutva forces, though nothing could be further from the truth, he says, every part of this country, from the most advanced to the most backward, from the aboriginal tribes to the highly cultivated and the educated, they are all a part of this nation. He says, nobody is outside the scope of the idea that is India. He also says they will come into it in different ways and at different paces. He mentions different religions. He mentions different people. He mentions tribals. And he says, all these are part of the Indian nation, but they will come into the nation building process in their own way at their own time. This complexity of accepting diversity and understanding how that diversity was going to constitute itself as a nation is something that was, I think, the hallmark of Indian nationalism. Bipin Chandra Pal, the extremist leader from Bengal, who came up with the idea or concept of composite nationalism. It was a fantastic contribution. What does composite mean? Composite means it is not exclusionary. It's a nationalism which combines in it the Hindu, the Muslim, the Sikh, the Christian. If it is a composite nationalism, it cannot be a Hindu nationalism. It cannot be a Muslim nationalism or a Sikh nationalism or any single religion-based nationalism or community-based or region-based nationalism. When you think of nationalism, you think of a single identity. But the moment you put in the word composite, as Bipin Chandra Pal did, it becomes something else. It becomes composed of various elements. Because something has to compose that composite nationalism. By its very nature, composite nationalism is also secular. It does not privilege any religion or religious community. Of course, later, Gandhiji made Hindu-Muslim unity one of the essential items of his political program from 1920 onwards. It became part and parcel of what you could call Indian nationalism. The national movement assured the minorities that their interests would not be trampled upon by the majority and ensured that the constitution incorporated these principles. That despite their best efforts, the national leaders could not check the growth of communal forces to the extent that they can prevent the partition of the country is no reflection on their secular credentials or on their efforts. Their commitment to the secular ideal is testified by their refusal to yield to the demands for a Hindu Rashtra and by their adoption of a secular constitution. Gandhiji's epic struggle against communal forces from 1946 to his martyrdom in the cause in January 1948 strengthened the secular fabric of the nation. The nationalist leadership also understood that while Indian nationalism could not be based on religious, regional, or linguistic or ethnic identities, at the same time, it was very important that these identities should feel, that none of these identities should feel that they are being suppressed or submerged into the Indian nation. This meant that the way in which Indian nationalism was defined and practiced, including must be such that the Hindus feel that they have full space for their interests, including religious interests, to flower. So should the Muslims, so should the Bengalis feel that their language and culture would prosper. And so should the Tamils, and so should the Malayalis. And so should the tribals feel that there was an equal place for them. So the conception of nationalism had to be multifaceted. It had to be inclusive. And at the same time, be what we today call non-homogenizing. It is very common nowadays in academic circles to use the word homogenizing nationalism. Homogenizing like an adjective to nationalism. They go together. As it is assumed that as in Europe, nationalism will homogenize, it will suppress all differences. But Indian nationalism from the beginning is imagined as and built as a non-hegemonizing, non-homogenizing nationalism. So it was a very interesting process through which different regions were guaranteed their linguistic, cultural, religious, and other identities, and that their interests were not just protected, but could flower and grow. This is how the idea of linguistic provinces came. India was divided under the British into presidencies and provinces, which included many linguistic units. For example, Madras Presidency included parts of Malayalam-speaking Kerala, parts of Telugu-speaking Andhra and Tamil-speaking areas. Bengal Presidency included Assam, Orissa, and Bihar, and so on. So in 1920, when Gandhiji became the leader of the national movement and he wrote a new constitution for the Congress, the first thing he did was to reorganize the Congress along linguistic lines. Earlier, there used to be a Bombay Presidency Provincial Congress Committee, a Madras Presidency Congress Committee. He now made it into Maharashtra Provincial Congress Committee. Gujarat, which was a part of Bombay Presidency, now became Gujarat Provincial Congress Committee, Sindh Provincial Congress Committee, Tamil Nadu Provincial Congress Committee. There was no such thing as Tamil Nadu then. Karnataka Provincial Congress Committee. So all the linguistic regions which weren't recognized by the Congress, by the British, were recognized by the Congress. This was done in order to give the people of every region the assurance that their language and their love for their language and culture was recognized and would have full space in an independent India. There were some other attributes of Indian nationalism as well, some of which became clear in the beginning and some of which developed over the years. Again, in the very early stages of the movement, you also find that, for example, Dadabhai Naraji, who first articulated the theory of economic nationalism, made it very clear that what Indian nationalism had to address itself to was the poverty of the Indian peasant. So he connected nationalism not to some abstract notion of the wealth of India, but concretely to the poverty of the peasants of India. His book analyzed that he showed how the drain of wealth is based on the taxation of the Indian peasant and on the indebtedness of the peasant, and how that goes into British coffers and how that then becomes the drain of wealth. Other national leaders also constantly talked about the poverty of the Indian peasant, the poverty that was a result of British rule. R.C. Dutt, for example, focused on the oppressive land revenue system, and his open letter to Lord Curzon actually led to a change in land revenue policy. Ranade, who was a High Court judge, investigated the indebtedness of the Maharashtra peasantry, which led to the Deccan riots of 1875. And he helped draft the Deccan Agriculturist Relief Act, which was the first ever ameliorative legislation, debt legislation passed by the British. Now, what does all this do? Why am I talking about all this? It's because this gives to the whole idea of Indian nationalism a concreteness, a pro-peopleness, a pro-poorness. That nationalism has to mean concrete things to real people. It is not just that it is good for the nation. What is this nation? The nation is the people. And who are these people? Primarily in India, it's the poor people. And primarily, it's the peasants. If nationalism has not done anything for the poor people, then what use is this nationalism? So this connection, which was made very early on, which you see continuing through Gandhi, through his notion of Daridra Narayan and through his politics of basing political activity on the mass of the people, that nobody should be outside the ambit of politics. What is the nation? The nation is the people of India. Nation is not a land. Nation is not an abstract entity of rivers, of mountains, a territory. A nation is its people. Jawaharlal Nehru, for example, he talks about in the discovery of India, the whole idea of Bharat Mata and how he explains to the peasants of India that they are the Bharat Mata. The Bharat Mata is not just the land. It is the people of India who are the Bharat Mata. Bharat Mata tum ho, he tells them. So this conception that Mother India is not this land, it is not this country, it is you, the people of India, who are Mother India. This is what Indian nationalism, how it was interpreted. This notion that the nation is its people, the notion that you are working for a nation, then you are working for the welfare of the people and not for some abstract glory of the nation, Mera Bharat Mahan. Not for some abstract recognition of being the first in the world, Vishwaguru. While 30% of the people live below the poverty line and you want to sit at the high table and that makes you happy and hug the highest and the, you know, richest in the world. In his famous Tryst with Destiny speech, the midnight of 14-15 August, Nehru said, defining Indian nationalism for Indians, he said, the service of India means the service of the millions who suffer. It means the ending of poverty and disease and inequality of opportunity. The Indian nationalist leaders had to address this question. Why do we need to throw out the British? Their answer was, we need to throw out the British not because they are white. There's nothing against the white race. Gandhiji said it again and again. We are nothing against the British. We are against imperialism. We are not against any Britisher. We are against the system, the imperial system. It is the system I want to break. I don't want to throw a single stone on a Britisher, said Gandhi. That's why nonviolence. I don't want to hurt a single Britisher. They are all cogs in the machine. Therefore, teaching the Indian people that what is oppressing you is the system and not some individual, not Christians, not white race people. Therefore, they are not going to be the targets of Indian nationalism. So this notion that what we were fighting was a system, and we are fighting it because it oppressed our people, it suppressed our culture, in the concrete sense of the term and not in some abstract sense, was a very important contribution which has gone into the making of what it is to be an Indian and what is the Indian nation. With Gandhiji, another very important feature came into the picture, apart from the notion of nonviolence, the implications of which we are yet to fully explore. How much it did for us and for the world needs to be talked about and discussed. Gandhiji's persona, his whole approach to politics, kept Indian nationalism free of any notion of aggression. He made it very humane. He made it very empathetic to the poor, empathetic to the disadvantaged. Nehru, again, I'm quoting in his speech, same speech, Tryst with Destiny speech, referring to Gandhiji, says, I quote Nehru now, the ambition of the greatest man of our generation has been to wipe every tear from every eye, unquote. This is what Gandhiji's idea of independence was. So simple and yet so profound. Nationalism means no tears in the eyes of the people of this country. The very fact that he did not talk about the glory of the nation, but of the welfare of each and every person. His talisman, whenever you are, for example, which says, whenever you are thinking, whenever you have a doubt about what next step you should take, what policy option you should choose, bring before you the face of the poorest person you have ever seen. And ask yourself what effect your step will have on him. And the answer will come to you immediately. You will not remain in a dilemma. If that step is going to help the poor person, then it is the right step. So he gave this humane, pro-people, pro-poor, empathetic quality to our nationalism. However, this nationalism, which we have talked about and which was bequeathed to us by our freedom struggle, which we have all absorbed through our own life experience, which we have understood through our studies, which we have learned from our families, through our parents, through our teachers, is now under severe challenge. We are presented with a nationalism that doesn't look to us like our own nationalism at all. In one horrific example a few years ago, the national flag, the Tiranga, was held aloft by people defending a rapist of a child belonging to a religion other than their own. Not far from Delhi, the national flag was used to wrap the body of a man accused of murdering another belonging to a different religion on suspicion that he had stored some beef in his fridge. My Tiranga being debased like this, the Tiranga for which thousands gave up their lives during the freedom struggle. In other parts of the country, innumerable incidents of attacks on individuals on various pretexts to prevent love jihad, to prevent cow slaughter, for example, have become common, all in the name of nationalism. Those who call themselves nationalists today have none of the attributes given to Indian nationalism by the freedom struggle. In fact, it must be said loudly and from the rooftops that the ideology they espouse was clearly described by our freedom struggle, by the greatest of our freedom fighters, by Gandhiji himself, as communalism, which is the antithesis of nationalism. It is not another variety of nationalism. It is the antithesis of nationalism. The word Hindu nationalism or the term Hindu nationalism is an oxymoron in India. If we are Indian people, then we cannot have a Hindu nationalism. It cannot be. Then we don't remain a nation. The term Hindu nationalism can only divide us. It cannot unite us. From Bhagat Singh to Gandhi, there was unanimity that communalism was the biggest hurdle to national unity. And it is this communalism, which must be called by its name, which is today masquerading as nationalism. It is this which is behind the targeting and silencing of powerful dissenting voices, as was witnessed in the murders of Pansare, of Dabolkar, of Kalburgi, and of Gauri Lankesh, by those who said they owed allegiance, who owed allegiance to communal organizations, but who called themselves nationalists. When writers returned their awards in protest, it was called a manufactured dissent by those who spoke in the name of Indian nationalism. These same nationalists, within quotes, buy up the media, pressurize the media, threaten the media, alert the media in order to control it. All this is done in the name of nationalism, and any criticism and dissent is instantly labeled as anti-national. At times, we feel that somebody else's distorted idea of nationalism is pushed down our throats, and we are told that to be a good nationalist, you have to be like this. Another feature of Indian nationalism, which is completely, which is under severe attack today, is that of civil liberties, freedom of expression, freedom of the press, freedom of association. These were critical parts of Indian nationalism. In fact, the struggles of the Indian nationalist, Tilak, for example, he was always at the receiving end of the British pressure. His press was confiscated so many times. As early as 1898, he was charged with sedition. Again, later, his press used to be attacked. It used to be confiscated. He was one of the staunchest fighters for civil liberties, for freedom of the press. So they were crucial parts of Indian nationalism. Gandhiji, for example, believed that there can be no limits to freedom of expression. And he didn't say this in independent India. He said it under the British. As early as 1921, at the height of the non-cooperation movement, he said, liberty of speech means it is unassailed, even when the speech hurts. Liberty of press can be said to be truly respected only when the press can comment on the severest terms upon and even misrepresent matters. That for him was liberty. You can't suppress it by saying that it is misrepresented, because your own version, it is your version of saying something is misrepresented. Any ruler can use it by saying that you misrepresented it. Therefore, who is to decide whether something is misrepresented or not? So Gandhiji said freedom of press means right of the press to misrepresent matters. Freedom of association is respected only when assemblies of people can discuss even revolutionary doings, is what he said. I'm quoting all the time. So they should be allowed to discuss revolutionary projects. The only line that he drew was non-violence, as is apparent from the next quotation. I quote, civil liberty consistent with the observance of non-violence is the first step towards Swaraj. So it becomes part of Swaraj. It is the breath of political and social life. It is the foundation of freedom. He doesn't conceive of freedom without civil liberty. Freedom has no value without it. I quote him again. It is the breath of political and social life. It is the foundation of freedom. And there is no room here for dilution of or compromise. It is the water of life. Life cannot be sustained without water. And civil liberties are like the water of life. So what is this freedom which doesn't have civil liberties? This is how he defined it. And what do we have today? We have the situation, as I just said to you, where every attempt is made to suppress the civil liberties of the people. I'm just sorry, I lost my... one sec. For example, section 124A, the section which is on sedition, even though the Supreme Court in 1962 had defined it very clearly that you can only charge somebody with sedition, that you have to prove imminent violence. That means the person getting excited by what is being said is immediately going to go and indulge in violence. There must be immediate threat. Yet the way this section has been used to suppress people, young people, in my university, for example, students in 2016, our young students were charged with this and they are still facing those cases. Even the charge sheet hasn't been framed yet, though 5 years have passed, but it is like a Damocles sword which is hanging above them. So what I want to say is that the present notion of aggressive chauvinistic nationalism, which is pervaded by the sectarian, some people call them communal fascist forces, is in sharp contrast to the one evolved by the freedom struggle. As I said earlier, India, or rather Bharat, is to be projected as a Vishwaguru. Mera Bharat has to be Mahan. In this version, citizenship is sought to be conferred or denied on grounds of religion, completely subverting the constitution and the legacy of the freedom struggle. All criticism is dubbed as anti-national and critics become urban Naxals. We know what is happening in the Bhima Koregaon case. Some of our best social activists are behind bars, and many of them for 3 years or more after being called urban Naxal, despite the fact that we have evidence now of how perhaps most of the evidence has actually been planted. Even a Navratna like Infosys, when we are talking all the time of Atmanirbhar, is accused of promoting the Tukre Tukre gang because there are some glitches, technical glitches in a digital platform. Nobody is safe. As we come to the field of education, things are extremely dire. There is a push towards centralization of education. There's an attempt to push a common syllabus onto all universities using the University Grants Commission, which actually has no business making syllabus. And crushing the diversity that we have in our education system. Education is supposed to be a state subject for good reason, because education was supposed to promote the regional language and it was supposed to also relate to people's culture and their history. So if you have a standardized syllabus, how are the different states going to talk about their own concerns, their own past, their own needs, their own history, their own sociology, their own policies, which they require, their own agrarian systems, in whichever subject you may talk about? This homogenizing nationalism, it completely takes away university autonomy and it links Bhartiyata to religion. And then it begins to target the minorities. mostly Muslims and Christians. It is very necessary. I would like to just elaborate a little bit before I come to a few other points on what this has meant for academic freedom and what it has meant to the universities, since I am from that field and I have greater knowledge and experience, and also perhaps feel extremely concerned, because academic freedom is also the foundation of intellectual freedom. If we crush intellectual freedom, where are we going to get new ideas from? And here I would like to just bring to your attention the kind of pressures which universities and academics have been facing. For example, using parliament, using bureaucracy, using the police, using the judiciary, using regulatory bodies such as the UGC, using university administrations, governing bodies of colleges and research institutes. What the powers that be have done is to target scholars who are critical of the establishment or represent a viewpoint different from the one that they believe in. The intimidation takes various forms. Some of them, for example, from suppression of books. We personally are victims of that. One of our books has been stopped from publication, a most popular book, the Hindi version of India's Struggle for Independence, which was published by the Delhi University 30 years ago, has been successfully suppressed. It has not been printed, not been published, even though Hindi books are so few and students are suffering. And of course, it is out in a pirated form. To denial of appointments, denial of promotions, denial of leave, even casual leave is denied, denial of leave to go and attend seminars, denial of retirement benefits. In my university, professors were not given retired benefits because they participated in a silent march in answer to a call given by the duly constituted Teachers Association, protesting against some action of the administration. There is denial, there is suspension and even dismissal of university professors. There's registration of cases against them. There is harassment by the police. Vigilante groups, RSS affiliated student bodies such as the ABVP, pro-establishment groups among the faculty, outside groups like sometimes Bajrang Dal, Hindu Sena, Karni Sena, depending on where you are used to prevent speakers that they do not approve of from participating in academic events on campuses, and in even physically attacking their targets among students and teachers. I would like to draw your attention to the most recent example of this, which I'm sure all of you have heard about, but I think that it is extremely important to talk about it. Just 2 or 3 weeks ago in the Hari Singh Gaur University in Madhya Pradesh, used to be called the Sagar University, a local ABVP unit complained to the police, and then the police sent a notice to the university about an invitation to two professors, Professor Gohar Raza and Professor Apurva Anand, who were going to participate online in a webinar that was being organized on the subject of scientific temper, on the ground that it may lead to enmity between communities and law and order situation. Why? Because the professors were supposed to be controversial. All that means is that they are not in favor of the powers that be. It also said that organizers will be responsible if there is any breach of peace. And mind you, this is an online seminar with international participation on a subject which is part of our constitutional duties. The result was that the Sagar University administration forced the sponsoring department to withdraw from the event. The international sponsor continued with the event. So security personnel was sent to the department to ensure that nobody was watching the event in their offices. Apart from the sheer absurdity of trying to stop people from watching something that is freely available at any place, they could be watching it outside in the lawns or in their homes or in the shopping center, anywhere, and on YouTube or anywhere later. I mean, this kind of gross misuse of the police and university authorities to push agendas promoted by student groups patronized by powerful political forces is setting a new normal. Extremely dangerous, must be resisted very strongly. Some time back, the government had even issued an order, which it later withdrew on objections from a large number of scientists, that permission had to be taken to invite any foreign scholar to an online event. What I'm really worried about is that this kind of thing leads to self-censorship. It is bound to lead to self-censorship. You get into the habit of thinking twice before expressing a sharply critical opinion in writing or in speech. Even class teaching is bound to be affected, especially in the social sciences. This in the long run will impact how students learn from example. We all learned from our teachers who were fearless in expressing their opinions. Original ideas only come when, as Tagore said, when your mind is without fear and the head is held high. So we will only regurgitate, as we have done for a long time, ideas handed out to us from high tables in other countries. So this is extremely dangerous, this attack, and that's why I wanted to emphasize it, and it took a few minutes extra on telling you what's happening in the academic field, because this has a multiplier effect and it crushes dissent of all kinds. It sets examples. It's meant to frighten people. And that's, I think it's something that we need to take extremely seriously. I also want to just come back to the more general points which I was making about the nature of this nationalism. And as I was saying, that this homogenizing nationalism, which links Bharatiyata to religion and targets minorities, the whole CAA and NRC business, the nature of that legislation, and the manner in which the movement against that legislation was targeted, how our young students and young protesters are still sitting in jail, people who were part of that movement, how the riots in northeastern Delhi, which were obviously in some way fomented and used then to target people who were actually prominent in the anti-CA and anti-NRC movement. I think these are all in the name of Indian nationalism. All these people are then projected as anti-national. That the claim, also I would like to say that this nationalism is not just anti-minority. It is elitist. It is anti-poor, it is anti-Kisan, anti-Mazdoor, anti-Dalit, anti-women. I don't have the time to go into all of these, but just the way it has treated the farmers of India, the Kisans of India, their first victory they have only won yesterday, which has managed to get that officer inquired into. But for almost 10 months, they've been struggling, and not even the formality of, you know, at least conceding talks to them. This is the way in which our migrant labor was treated last year. Those images cannot be forgotten by any Indian. How we treated our poor and how we continue to treat our poor silently, the unemployment figures. We think that by giving 5 kg of gehu or rice, we have done our duty by our poor. A country which was built on the notion of the Ridra Narayan, a country that was built through the sacrifices of people like Mahatma Gandhi, that we can satisfy ourselves by handing out 5 kg of rice or wheat to our poor and feel very great about it. That this claim to nationalism is false is also shown by the way they are messing up with national icons, such as the Jallianwala Bagh, the Sabarmati Ashram, the whole destruction of the central vista. It's not a renovation or a redoing. It's a destruction, wanton destruction. The parliament building where the Constituent Assembly met, the National Museum, which holds our prized treasures, the National Archives. You name it, the Vigyan Bhavan, which is the symbol of post-independence India. It was our first big building, you know, where big conventions were held, where the world leaders came. And of course, it's tied to the Nehruvian vision. So it has to be destroyed. Anything to do with Nehru has to be destroyed. If the first principle of nationalism is that its objective, its raison d'etre is to unify the people, then can an ideology which divides the people who constitute the nation call itself nationalism? That is my final question, and there I will end. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this exhaustive presentation, madam. Starting from the ancient times to how the Indian nationalism progressed and how the whole idea of composite nationalism came up. And the present situation, beautiful picture you have put forward before us. There are many questions in the chat box, but before I invite those, those questions, I would like to invite our friend and comrade Ravi to make some initial comments. Ravi Sina, comrade Ravi Sina.
Oh, can you hear me? My net is very unstable. I got thrown. Thank you so much, Professor Mukherjee. You know, it's such a lucid lecture. Subhash calls me on first so that we get one more opportunity from the NSI side to express our gratitude to the speaker. And it is such an honor for us to have your talk this evening. It was such a lucid lecture. The question I have is, I have asked many friends, many speakers, and I keep repeating the question that what do you think about the role of democracy vis-a-vis emancipatory and progressive nationalism, idea of nation in our kind of countries? Sometimes one feels that democracy, especially vigorous, competitive electoral democracy in our kind of society, comes in the way of emancipatory and progressive nationalism. So I would like if you could comment on that. And also because of this, are there any examples of defeating majoritarian fascist kind of powers that come to power through democracy, by democratic means? You know, I mean, the classic example of Hitler, you know, I mean, that was war took care of, and the whole world took care of him, but the war took care of him. Are there other examples of when in countries like ours, when Hindu majoritarian identity has come to the help of fascist forces, what way you see to defeat them democratically? So relationship of democracy with progressive nationalism, how do you see that?
Would you like me to answer now?
Please.
Okay. Firstly, I think, as Nehru said, you know, democracy has its faults. Gandhiji had many names for it, but as both of them also said, we haven't yet got a better system. So, you know, so others are worse. This doesn't mean that this is the final, it's not the end of history. That's why we talk about deepening of democracy. Also, I think more importantly, I would like to say that, you know, when we talk about democracy, we automatically always think of the electoral part of democracy. I think especially in our country, we should not think of it in those terms. We have such a strong tradition of resistance. What I learned from Gandhi most of all is the tradition of resistance. If there is an essence to Gandhi for me, it is resistance. And today also I see, of course, the electoral field is important. We cannot ignore that. Ultimately, things have to come in through the elections. But I'm so inspired by what's going on, for example, in the Kisan movement, you know. Look at the way that resistance had, when nobody expected it. You know, they do not even have the support of big national parties. No, they are, many of them are small trade unions, which have, you know, there are some of them are really small ones. Some of them are pan-provincial, but others are pretty small. But they've been sustaining themselves from now for so long. Areas which were not there in the beginning have been drawn in. People who were not there at leadership levels have now emerged as leaders. That's the hallmark of a genuine mass movement. If resistance is on right issues, if it attracts people, if it's somewhere addressing itself to the genuine needs of the people. And, the, you know, and like I think that the Kisan movement in India is more than just about those three laws. I think it's about saving a whole way of life. I think those Kisans know that they are fighting not just for one law or another, but they're fighting to preserve the whole system of peasant production, which is a human heritage, which is sought to be destroyed. It's their culture is nothing without that system of production. So they are protecting a whole way of life. And that is why it resonates so deeply in them. And genuine mass movements come when things resonate very deeply. You know, this is what Gandhi was able to do. He was able to reach into the deepest recesses of the Indian mind, of the Indian peasant, and draw them out, because somewhere he could relate, you know. So I think that when I think about democracy, I also would like to emphasize that movements of resistance, mass movements, intellectual movements, cultural movements, these are what are the heart of democracy. So when we say, can democracy defeat authoritarian regimes, fascist regimes, I would like to think of all these things. And of course, we had almost fascist, whatever, however you want to define it, but Trump did get defeated very recently. Despite what happened in the beginning of January, all kinds of attempts being made. I mean, it was a crazy situation, but whatever it was, the American people did defeat him, despite so many institutions being subverted. Bolsonaro seems to be on the way out. We might still have Lula back in power, despite all the efforts that have been made to marginalize him. So, you know, of course it is difficult. But I would also say that what I find, you know, it's always actual examples that inspire me or give me hope. It's not just what's happening in the Kisan movement. I think long drawn out movements also then come up with different kinds of solutions to problems. Just, I mean, we have been talking about the spread of communalism in Western UP now, and with the 2013 riots as a prime example of how a people who could not be divided at the time of partition, you know, it is held up as an example where there was no violence at that time. No, but in 2013, the communal ideology spread enough to actually end up in communal violence. And how was this going to be reversed? Just look at the way they've done it in that movement. Through something that sounds like simple things, by apologizing, you know, by saying, yes, we did it, but we were wrong. We now understand. We were made fools of by the politicians and we fell for it. You know, that kind of acceptance of guilt and then apology has cleared the air. When you read the accounts of the Mahapanchayat, which happened in Muzaffarnagar 2 weeks ago, that among the langars, you know, there were how many of them which were by Muslims alone, where they were welcoming the people, that the slogans, a different meaning is given to slogans like Har Har Mahadev and Allahu Akbar can be used to divide. But the movement found a simple way of using the same slogans to unite. You know, so I think we need to, you know, creatively link. The only answer is to creatively link with people's movements, link electoral democracy with actual movements, you know, and of course, intellectuals' role is very important. The cultural part is also extremely important, I think, because that's the medium through which we can really reach people. I don't know if I gave an adequate answer, but, you know.
Kumar Ketkar ji has mentioned one question. I will ask him to please. Kumar ji, please say out loud. Say it. Aap khud boliye, bataiye ek question.
Actually, I have written the question.
Yeah.
At the outset, I must say it was a very profound interpretation, and which was urgently needed for nationalism as well as idea of India. But my question is, despite such strong roots in the freedom movement, such strong roots in Gandhi's idea, Gandhi's image, Gandhi's thoughts in every single village, and yet how could we fast degenerate effectively in just about one decade or two to this kind of semi-fascist state or fascist state? How the people who were brought up in the freedom movement and freedom ideas, secular ideas, genuine humanistic ideas, degenerate so quickly? That is one. And second, what is the role of capitalism? In the sense, in the freedom struggle, there was national bourgeoisie, which was part of the Indian freedom struggle. How come the same so-called national bourgeoisie has so quickly surrendered in the name of corporate capitalism to this majoritarian, non-Indian, non-nationalistic state? Can that national bourgeoisie reassert itself, or it is already dead?
Please.
Both questions are very difficult, which is to be expected from Kumarji. He never asks simple questions. And he's a tough taskmaster. Okay, the first one. Yes, of course. I think to try and answer your question, where did we go wrong? You know, what were the weaknesses in the post-independence scenario? I think there was, you know, traditions can only take you that far. You have to tradition, as they say, there is a book, famous book called The Invention of Tradition. You know, traditions have to be invented, reinvented. They don't last just like that. When you say sanskar in a family, it's the parents or the grandparents who take those traditions to the younger generation. And that's how they become traditions, you know? But if there is a gap, if the parents don't know the tradition, the grandparents don't know the traditions, where are the children going to pick it up from? So tradition of the freedom struggle had to be kept alive, had to be then transmitted through different modes. And I think the fact that we see, especially among the younger people, where this ideology has spread the fastest, does mean that we have failed in the way that it could be carried forward. One big route was the education system. And there, I think we, despite some good efforts, we did not really go very far in actually changing, for example, the content of school textbooks. Only by the National Integration Council came into being early 60s, by the time they understood the problem, they started the whole thing of writing new textbooks, etc. But even those textbooks, even by the end of it, only CBSE schools were using it. I'm talking about history and social science textbooks. They understood that the earlier textbooks were colonial and communal. They had to be changed. But then a lot of the state boards did try to use those and all that, but they didn't spread very far. Most of the textbooks that were still in use in India, now, of course, things are much worse. Even by the 80s and the 90s, when other books were available, were actually popular books brought out by local publishers. You know, so certainly a very important vehicle of transmitting and carrying on the ideas of the freedom struggle, which was through the education system, was lost. That opportunity was lost. I think even once we realized it, once communalization of education started in a big way, especially in the first NDA government, and then the Congress, UPA came back to power, there was a lot of talk about detoxification and all that. But actually, I think from 2004 till 2014, those 10 years, we again lost the plot. I don't think we did even one, what shall I say, figures are wrong, one-tenth of what we should have done or could have done. you know, again, not only just textbooks, syllabus, there was a big attack. And we knew what was wrong. But dissemination at a popular level through cultural forms, countering the communal ideology, how much did we counter it in those 10 years? How much did we bring back the ideas of the freedom struggle in those 10 years? You know, because somewhere, I don't know, we think power, it's the whole concern with electoral change and all that. You're spending all your time counting the caste arithmetic. Which caste will fit in here? How can I win my next election by making this concession, by giving a few more reservation points here? This is where we get stuck. The understanding that ultimately those same people belonging to the same castes also respond to ideological inputs, ideological mobilization. You know, when you have seen it in action, but it doesn't enter into our consciousness deep enough. All parties, I would say, including on the left, I think there is a greater understanding, but still nowhere near what we need of understanding the ideological dimension and going for it. You know, so I think that is a big, big weakness, and a lot remains to be done over there. The second point which you talked about was...
bourgeoisie.
Yes. I mean, it is indeed quite fantastic. The capitulation. I would say that it's with... that they are seeing their short-term interest. I think the difference between the national bourgeoisie in the colonial period was that they had a leadership who could ask them to and make them sacrifice their short-term interest, which was to cater to the British, get concessions from the British, in their long-term interest to sacrifice their short-term. The long-term interest was to ally with the nationalist forces, because they could only grow when colonialism went. So this, they had the Pushottam Das Thakur Das, for example, J.D. Birla, for example, the Chambers of Commerce. There were so many people, names are not coming readily to mind, but there was a galaxy of actually intellectuals among the leadership of the bourgeoisie. Some of them were themselves capitalists and others were, you know, people who were representatives of the capitalists. So I think this is also something we need to realize. And when I was talking, therefore, about Indian nationalism, I was emphasizing the intellectual aspect. Does this bourgeoisie now have that kind of quality of leadership, which understands the difference between short-term and long-term? They've been brought up probably on license quota. You know, you manipulate, you buy up this MP or you buy up this leader and you get what you want. They have no vision. Do they have a modernizing vision? Even the Tatas seem to have somewhere, you know, gone a little bit astray, you know, who were supposed to be having at least some kind of welfarist vision. But, you know, so I think, I don't know how else to explain it, but in terms of an inability to see. Because if they knew the history of fascism, they would know what happens to them. They are used and then dumped. So they'll be used to buy up media houses. But tomorrow they'll be dumped also when it becomes uncomfortable. Because authoritarian regimes work only for themselves. Everybody has to kowtow to them. You know, so I would say that, you know, they need to look for some leaders. maybe they should invite some intellectuals to become their leaders.
one small rejoinder, madam.
Yes.
Very small rejoinder. Not only the values of the freedom movement and the idea of nationalism as given by the freedom movement and Gandhiji and Nehru has come in decline, but also the other things like scientific temper, that has gone out the window. Then the idea of civil society, which you talked about brilliantly about resistance movement, and institutions, How come all the institutions, almost all the institutions, from election commission to CBI to Supreme Court to media to Reserve Bank to UGC to all the academic institutions, how all of them have so quickly, so why institutional autonomy could not be, you know, could not be actually carried forward?
I agree. I think, therefore, one needs to look deeper. And one needs to see, even before this kind of communal authoritarian regimes, where even when otherwise the democratic system was functioning with all its faults, etc., we did play around with institutions. I know in the universities, and you know, Ketkar, that vice chancellors were appointed for all kinds of reasons other than academic is not a new problem. Only here now it's being used to do it for ideological reasons. There it was for personal, for caste, for money, for coterie reasons. But you played around with institutions. You didn't really respect institutions. You didn't really have that kind of what you needed, especially, if I may say so, at various provincial levels. I don't want to name states. I don't want to name universities. Openly, it would be said, so-and-so vice chancellor, this much money. And I'm talking about 20 years ago, 30 years ago, not. Also, I think the decline in the quality of education. You know, ultimately, you need proper training of the mind, to understand scientific temper, to not fall prey to. I mean, if a good education is a vaccination against, becoming prey to these kind of ideas, a good scientific education. Have we had Professor Ravi Sinha is here, He knows what are the faults in our scientific education. Are we teaching science in the schools in India? The excitement of science. Does any Indian kid, apart from some good schools maybe, get a sense that science is about discovering this universe? What is it all about? Where does life come from? Where does that sun, why does it happen? No, science is about rattling some formulas, some chemistry equations. Are you good at science? It's because you score 99, not because you may not even thought about the fact that science is about understanding your world, So I think the poor quality of education at every level, which is there. I mean, we know. I know. I can tell you from JNU that we could see how education decline was happening in which province, from the increase in the numbers of students who were coming to JNU from that province. Where there is good education available in your own city or your own province, you will go there. Why will you go so far away? Because education has declined in your state, So, but it was there. I mean, from the 70s, 80s, a kind of decline. There are various reasons. There was, for example, use of regional languages in college and university education. But we did it without adequate textbooks. Good ideas, reach out to people, democratization of education. But where was the content in Telugu or Marathi or even Bengali or Marathi? Did you have all the books that you needed in science or in sociology? We put the cart before the horse. In Japan, yes, they do everything in Japanese. But a journal, a rare, obscure journal gets translated in 2 months into Japanese and is available to the Japanese professor. Ask Ravi Sinha, he will tell you in science, they don't suffer. But we did all that. So what happened? Our standards went down. So, I mean, it's complex. I'm only mentioning a few things which, from my own understanding and experience, which we need to look at, critically at ourselves. Because we need to strengthen those. We need, if and when we get the chance to rectify, which is not easy. It is not going to come easy. And rectification is not easy. Destruction is very easy. But let me give you an example. I would say that, I'm not saying it because I'm from JNU, but I've seen it very closely over the last few years, particularly from 2016, when there's been a vicious attack on the university in every sense of the term. It has still not succumbed. It is still fighting. People have fought. People have sacrificed. But you also have to see the intensity of the attack. Of course, we are in the direct line of fire because we've been favorites for a long time, you know. But I can tell you it's also very difficult to resist. But people have resisted. But the kind of insidious ways in which it is done also, people don't know. JNU faculty has filed 250 odd cases, students and faculty, against the university in the High Court. There used to be a joke that they should reserve a room in the High Court for us because we are there all the time. And they have won out of them 220 because their cause was right and they could still find good judges. You know, but the attack, the viciousness of it, and of course, Corona is great because you have cleaned the campus of university teachers and students. Universities, the administrations are very happy. No students, no teachers, no agitation, no resistance. What do you do? Online resistance. What do I do? Our teachers' representatives in the executive council or in the academic council, now everything is online. So the mics are just turned off. You mute me, you don't hear me. And then you say technical glitch ho gaya. You know?
Sorry, there are many questions in the chat box. Yes, and many have been raised. So there's one question.
As long as my throat holds, I will answer.
Rajiv Mandal wants to know whether India has turned into ethnic democracy. Rajiv Mandal.
Yes.
Would like to answer that?
Yes, it is a new term. I mean, it's not so new. It's been used for some time now. And recently, there's a book by Geoffrey Law with that name, India and Ethnic Democracy. You know, the attempt is to distinguish between what they call, you know, a civic democracy and an ethnic democracy. A civic democracy is supposed to be based on secular ideas of citizenship. And ethnic democracy is supposed to be based on some ethnic identity like religion or, you know, race or what it could be, whatever. Ethnic, the content of that ethnic can vary. It's okay. I mean, I'm not too kicked by description. It can be used to make a point or two, but I don't think the whole of it rests on that. I think, firstly, I don't think the civic part of the democracy in India has vanished. The attack is on it, yes, but I'm not too satisfied with this formulation. It's a useful tool to understand a little bit. But I don't think it encapsulates the whole of what is wrong. It's that is not the only issue that it is emphasizing what they call ethnic. Firstly, ethnic word, you know, is used in various ways. It's actually the content religion into ethnic is also a little troublesome because originally it was used more to talk about you know, let's say racial identity, I would say tribal world, then I would say ethnic difference, you know, even to language, it was stretched. Religion is a new kind of thing that's added to it. Because it's got more to do with ethnic origins, it's got more to do with, you know, the kind of people you are, rather than religion is still something you acquire. Okay? You're not born into a particular, you know. And it's democracy also, you know, I think what we need to question is the problems with the democratic content of the democracy. It's not a question of it's one kind of democracy or other. Okay, I think it's sacrificing the democracy. It's the weakness in democracy that we are seeing. That's what we're worried about. If civil liberties are curtailed, if freedom of press is curtailed, you know, if people are thrown into jail without a cause, then I need to ask, forget ethnic or civic or whatever, is it a democracy at all? Or how much of that democratic part has been sacrificed? Have we lost? No? So I think that I would say that, you know, it's therefore for that reason I find it very inadequate as a characterization. I wouldn't end there.
बजरंग तिवारी जानना चाहते हैं कि क्या यह माना जाए कि जनोन्मुखी राष्ट्रवाद ने जो अवधारणा ने जो स्वीकृति प्राप्त की है उसे उन्मादी राष्ट्रवाद ने हड़प लिया, ये पूछना जानना चाहते हैं, ये उनका प्रश्न है।
हड़पने की कोशिश की जा रही है जोरों से उस राष्ट्रवाद को नहीं हड़प लिया, पर राष्ट्रवाद का जो कॉन्सेप्ट है, राष्ट्रवाद का जो विचार है, उसको उसका सहारा लेके, मेरा पॉइंट ये है कि राष्ट्रवाद का सहारा लेके कुछ और चीज को की बात की जा रही है। हम इस सांप्रदायिकता को राष्ट्रवाद नहीं मानते, ये बात मैं एम्फसाइज करना चाहती हूँ कि हमारे ट्रेडिशन में इसका नाम सांप्रदायिकता है, इसका नाम राष्ट्रवाद है ही नहीं। और ये आज की बात नहीं है, ये कम से कम 90 साल पहले जब जवाहरलाल नेहरू ने पहली बारी कम्युनलिज्म की सांप्रदायिकता की व्यापक रूप से उन्होंने विश्लेषण किया था, तो ये एक सबसे जरूरी चीज उन्होंने उसी वक्त की थी कि मजॉरिटी कम्युनलिज्म मैस्करेड्स एज नेशनलिज्म, कैन ईजिली मैस्करेड एज नेशनलिज्म, माइनॉरिटी कम्युनलिज्म बिकम सेपरेटिज्म एंड मजॉरिटी कम्युनलिज्म मैस्करेड्स एज नेशनलिज्म ऑलवेज टेक्स द क्लोक because it can project its interests as national interests because they are belonging to the majority. ye warning unhone tab bhi di thi, aur ek aur warning unhone aur di thi jo ki mujhe lagta hai ki bar bar dohrana zaruri hai.
ek chhota cheez unhone jo mere pe aapke samne aadha hi prashna maine rakha tha wahi ki unhone kaha ki ye is rashtravad ka sara matlab kel bhasha mein chala uska sammohan bhi bhasha ke bal par kayam hai. और ये वो आगे जानना चाहते हैं कि क्या ये सॉरी मैं आगे ठीक से पढ़ नहीं पा रहा हूँ कि क्या सॉरी ये तो क्या किया जाए, यही प्रश्न सॉरी.
हाँ, तो मैं ये कह रही थी कि एक चीज और जवाहरलाल नेहरू ने जो तभी एक्सप्लेन करी थी कि हिंदुस्तान में आपको पता है कि वो फासिज्म नाथिज्म के बहुत कीन स्टूडेंट थे. जब शुरू ही हुई थी ये फोर्सेज यूरोप में अर्ली 30s में, तब से वो वॉर्न कर रहे थे कि फासिज्म आ रहा है, फासिज्म आ रहा है. और उसके क्रिटिक तो थे ही, पर उसके स्टूडेंट थे, मतलब उसको बहुत ध्यान से उन्होंने पढ़ा, समझा, अटेंशन दी. तो उनका ये कहना था कि हिंदुस्तान में अगर फासिज्म आएगा तो वो सांप्रदायिकता का रूप लेके आएगा, इस फॉर्म में आएगा. और ये बहुत प्रिसाइंट बात, बहुत समझ की बात उन्होंने कही थी. हमें ये याद रखना चाहिए कि नेकेड फॉर्म में नहीं आएगा, इस फॉर्म में आएगा. अच्छा, जो इन्होंने कहा कि उसको किस तरह से, एक बार एंड में क्या बोला दोबारा उन्होंने, सम्मोहन क्या था, मैं ठीक से समझ नहीं पाई.
ये साला खेल भाषा का चला.
अच्छा,
मैं थोड़ा सॉरी, मैं हाँ. पढ़ नहीं पाया था. ये इस राष्ट्रवाद का सारा खेल भाषा में चला, उसका सम्मोहन भी भाषा के बल पर कायम है, तो इस सम्मोहन से छुटकारा पाने के लिए वो कहते कि
राष्ट्रवाद की भाषा को ही छोड़ना पड़ेगा शायद, क्या इनका ये इशारा है. हाँ, इसी पे एक पॉइंट है जो कि मेरा लेक्चर काफी लंबा हो जा रहा था, इसलिए मैंने सोचा कि सवाल जवाब में इस पे और विस्तार में कहूंगी. थोड़ा सा तो शुरू में मैंने कहा ही था, और ये चीज तो सोचने वाली है आप सबको फ्यूचर के लिए, कि अब जो है ये राष्ट्रवाद का प्रेजेंट डे डेफिनेशन क्या होना चाहिए, फ्यूचर के लिए हमें उसका विजन क्या बनाना चाहिए, व्हाट इज द नेशनलिस्ट विजन फॉर द फ्यूचर, किस राष्ट्रवाद के साथ हम ये सांप्रदायिकता का जो अपने आप को राष्ट्रवाद बताता है उसका हम सामना करेंगे. राष्ट्रवाद की भाषा को ड्रॉप कर देना, राष्ट्रवाद वर्ड को छोड़ देना, ये हमारे हाथ में नहीं है. हम उसको छोड़ देंगे, दूसरे लोग नहीं छोड़ेंगे, वो उसका गैर इस्तेमाल करेंगे. हमारा काम है उसका ठीक इस्तेमाल करना, क्योंकि अभी भी ये जवाहरलाल नेहरू ने भी तब कहा था, बहुत इंटरेस्टिंग बात है, उन्होंने कहा था कि नेशनलिज्म बहुत पावरफुल फोर्स है, अभी आसानी से खत्म होने वाला नहीं है. क्योंकि अभी भी दुनिया में इंपीरियलिस्ट फोर्सेस है, आज भी है. इकोनॉमिक इंपीरियलिज्म अभी कम है क्या? और पॉलिटिकल भी कोई कम नहीं है. अभी अफगानिस्तान में जो हो रहा है, इतना मिक्स्ड अप सिचुएशन इसलिए भी तो है वहां पे, कोई क्लियर कट स्टैंड नहीं ले पा रहे लोग वहां पे, क्योंकि एक डोमिनेशन तो था एक बाहर के देश का वहां पे. तो ये फोर्सेस अभी भी जो एक एलिमेंटल फोर्स है नेशनलिज्म का, ये लोगों को अभी भी अफेक्ट करता है, उनको प्रेरित करता है. मुझे लगता है कि प्रोग्रेसिव फोर्सेस के लिए बहुत जरूरी है कि उसको प्रोग्रेसिव एजेंडा के साथ लिंक करें, जैसे हमारे फ्रीडम स्ट्रगल में किया. उसका कंटेंट दूसरा बनाइए, जैसे मैंने कहा प्रो पुअर, आप उसको सोशलिस्ट कंटेंट बनाइए. अगर आप सोशलिस्ट है बताइए, बस सोशलिज्म भी तो बताना पड़ेगा कि उसका आज क्या कंटेंट है. सिर्फ वर्ड से तो कुछ नहीं हो सकता. सोशलिज्म का भी अगर आप कंटेंट नहीं बताएंगे तो ये कहा जाएगा कि आप तो वो मरा हुआ सोवियत सोशलिज्म ला के फेंक रहे हैं हमारे सामने. तो कंटेंट बताना पड़ेगा हर एक चीज का. आज हम सिर्फ सोशलिज्म कह के भी चुप नहीं कर सकते, क्योंकि उसकी भी बड़ी मिक्स्ड लेगेसी है जो कि हमारे ऊपर फेंकी जाएगी. तो हमारा जिम्मेवारी बनती है, चाहे वो वर्ड नेशनलिज्म हो चाहे सोशलिज्म हो, उसको हमको डिफाइन करना है. जैसे मैं अगर कहूं तो मैं कहूंगी कि मैं सोशलिज्म की अगर बात ही करूंगी तो सबसे पहले मैं कहूंगी कि मैं डेमोक्रेटिक सोशलिज्म में विश्वास करती हूँ. मैं टोटेलिटेरियन में नहीं करती, मैं रिजेक्ट करती हूँ, चाहे वो सोवियत हो चाहे चाइनीज हो चाहे कुछ है. अगर मैं वो नहीं करूंगी तो मैं आगे ही नहीं बढ़ सकती, मैं वहीं पे बैठ जाऊंगी, मेरे ओपोनेंट वहीं पे जीत जाएंगे. क्योंकि बगैर डेमोक्रेसी को साथ में जोड़े हम आगे नहीं ले जा सकते. इसी तरह नेशनलिज्म का भी जहां तक सवाल है, उसका एक तो इकोनॉमिक कंटेंट क्या होगा. अब आज के आपके सामने सवाल है, किसान मूवमेंट ने आपके सामने 100 सवाल लाके खड़े कर दिए हैं कॉन्क्रीटली. आप बताइए आपका विजन क्या है एग्रीकल्चर पे, आप बताइए आपका इंडस्ट्री में क्या विजन है. आत्मनिर्भर भारत वो कह रहे हैं, आप बताइए आपका आत्मनिर्भर है के इंटरडिपेंडेंट वर्ल्ड है, क्या है. ये जरूरी है फ्लैश आउट करना. इसीलिए मैं कहती हूँ इंटेलेक्चुअल्स का रोल बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट होता है, क्यों ये चीजें सिर्फ एक स्पॉन्टेनियसली नहीं बन के आती है, इनमें बहुत हार्ड सोच की जरूरत. पर वो विजन बनाना हमारे लिए बहुत जरूरी है. सिर्फ एक अपोजिंग आइडियोलॉजी से नहीं काम चलता, जो ऑल्टरनेटिव विजन बनाना बहुत जरूरी है. महिलाओं की अगर हम बात करते हैं तो ठीक है, ये एंटी वुमेन है, ये सांप्रदायिकता एंटी वुमेन है. हम कहते रहते हैं तो तालिबान की से मिलता जुलता है, ये है वो है. पर हमारा विजन क्या है वुमेन के लिए? सिर्फ एक वुमेन्स रिजर्वेशन बिल की बात करते करते कब कहां कितनी दूर जाएंगे? बहुत कुछ हो सकता है उसका कंटेंट. आप क्या सोचते हैं महिलाओं के लिए? आपका क्या विजन है? बच्चों के लिए आपका क्या विजन है? एजुकेशन के लिए आपका क्या विजन है? हमारा जो आज का एजुकेशन सिस्टम है, राइट टू एजुकेशन बहुत अच्छी बात है, राइट टू एजुकेशन का कंटेंट. अब 2 साल में बच्चों का जो हाल हो गया है, वी हैव यू नो ब्रॉट इनटू बीइंग एन इलिटरेट जनरेशन ऑफ स्कूल गोइंग चिल्ड्रन. दे कैन नॉट रीड ए बी एंड सी. अभी प्रथम के वो रिपोर्ट्स देखिए आप, यू नो. तो हर एक चीज में एक ऑल्टरनेटिव नेशनल विजन जिसका कॉन्टेंट हो वो जरूरी है. मैं कहूंगी कि इसी तरह से हम नेशनलिज्म को एक नया कंटेंट देने की हमें जरूरत है. आप म्यूट पे हैं.
चौधरी वांट्स टू नो व्हाई हिस्टोरियंस एंड अदर स्कॉलर्स आर नॉट एज क्रिटिकल टू द प्री ब्रिटिश रूलर्स एज दे आर फॉर ब्रिटिश एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन. And so, but it's a long question. For example, the standard explanation is that British is foreign, whereas others are domestic, or British his history is relatively recent. So, is it because modern British society takes such criticism sportively, unlike the other societies, or is there other real reason? She's comparing, what's your opinion about this depiction of British rule and earlier rules?
I think I will go back to Tilak to answer your question. when Tilak defined Swaraj, He said, Swaraj is not about religion, it's not about culture, it is about interests. Anybody who works in the interests of India, I call that Swaraj. And he said, Balikambar Swaraj. He specifically mentions Muslim rulers of an earlier period to say they were Swaraj. He said, Akbar Swaraj. And he says, we are against the British is because they are against our interests. Okay? So independence, nationalism was defined in terms of protecting the interests of the people of India, the whole notion of colonialism. My basic answer is going to be to the question is critical of British rule because it was a colonial rule. There was drain of wealth. Indian economy was subjugated to the British economy. Politically, India was subjugated. Even your ruling classes were subjugated. Even your Maharajas were not equal to the British. They were not partners. Even your Zamindars were politically subjugated. You were culturally subjugated. So it was a complete subjugation, as Amilcar Cabral says. Colonialism is an interruption in the history of a people. I think he expresses it so powerfully. It is as if the history of a people stops when colonial rule comes. And you have to start it all over again because it is that kind of a violent disruption. Okay, that's the difference between colonial and pre-colonial rule. It is not that there was not exploitation and peasants were the same as Zamindars or Akbar and his... The Kashtakar lived at the same level? Of course not. You know, the exploitation was very much there. Irfan Habib has written a whole book, and so have others, describing the degree of economic exploitation of the peasantry. Agrarian struggles against the Mughal rule were how the Mughal empire fell, is what Irfan Habib has taught us. So it's not that not critical of earlier regimes. R.S. Sharma wrote about Shudras in ancient India. So many scholars have written about the caste system and its negative effects and so much else. It's not that we are not critical. You look with a critical eye on entire Indian history. In fact, the criticism of scholars like us is you don't glorify the Indian past. You are critical of the Indian ancient past. We are supposed to glorify the ancient past, criticize the medieval past, remain silent on the British. You know, that's what good history is supposed to be today.
Maya Pandit wants to know, do you think that the Kamdal mentality was alive under the cover of Indian nationalism? For instance, the caste question or the women's rights issue, these changes were always resisted right from the beginning.
I don't agree that in the mainstream Indian national movement, women's issues and caste issues were always neglected or were suppressed. I'm sorry. My reading, my understanding of Gandhiji, for example, and of course other, Rana Day, let's go back to Rana Day, who started the Indian Social Conference. So social reform was a part of the agenda of the Indian nationalists from the very beginning. The debate in the early days was, should it happen under the banner of the Congress or not? That was the issue. Not that social reform should not happen. Yes, Tilak was against certain social reform measures because he had a different understanding. His understanding was that political freedom is primary. Secondly, he believed social reform should come through community action. He did not want to rely on British legislation. Whereas other Indian nationalists said, for a good cause, we can also take the help of the British. So these were differences in perspective. But the mainstream of Indian nationalism, especially from after Gandhiji's coming from 1920 onwards, anti-untouchability becomes an integral part of Congress program. So the idea that social reform cannot be allied to the national movement or cannot be part of Congress program, that debate ends with Gandhi because he makes the struggle against untouchability, a crucial part, non-cooperation movement program. If you see the different items, Hindu-Muslim unity, Khadi, Charkha, boycott, this, that, and struggle against untouchability from 20. Then we all know that He made it his life's mission. We cannot forget his, I'm just giving star, I mean, very loud examples like the Harijan tour, 1933. He comes out of jail after the Pune Pact, and for 9 months, he's on the road. After spending almost 1 year and then another more than 1 year in jail, he doesn't go back to Sabarmati. He doesn't go back to an ashram, to no home. Is it not a normal human being who would like to go back to a home? Think if you were on the road for 9 months, touring by bullock cart, by walking, by boat, by train, by car, in the remotest parts of India, the only politics within quotes, he says, no politics. I'm calling it politics because I think it is politics. Social reform is also politics. Integral part of politics, of correct politics, genuine politics, which he did. He went from village to village arguing against untouchability. He was attacked in Pune. You're from Maharashtra. There was a bomb attack on his entourage. Some people were hurt as well because they didn't like his anti-caste campaign. And of course, he was viciously attacked by the Sanatanists, by the orthodox sections. So he would go and he would sit in the temple compound in the village and say, Aiye shastrat kariye, let's talk, let's dialogue. Use the old Indian tradition of arguing, which pandits used to argue. He's not a pandit, he's a banya. But he will argue with you on Indian tradition and show to you how castes, the caste system, what is wrong with untouchability. So he campaigned day and night, and not just through his tour. He wrote like a madman. He started in jail. He starts his campaign against untouchability. He started the magazine Harijan. He set up the organization also against untouchability. And he collected money for it, of course. Virtually wrote the whole of Harijan. That magazine used to be articles by him only. How that man could do all that, you have no, sitting in jail, going on fasts after the other. And then he carries on this campaign. He says, I will not do any politics for the next 2 years. And he doesn't. He only takes up the issue. Which in which country, which leader of a national liberation struggle, whose word was law to billions, do you have this kind of an example of taking up a social issue, or any kind of social issue? In other country, it could be race, it could be this, it could be that. Do you have any such example of the similarly what he did in from 46 till he died, taking up the issue of communal violence, of communalism, as he said, which has entered people's hearts? How he went to Noakhali when cabinet mission is sitting in Delhi. Or cabinet mission has gone, but negotiations for transfer of power are going on. He sits in a remote village and goes from village to village barefoot to carry the message. On women, again, I think it's a canard to say. I think I would say that during the period of the freedom struggle, Gandhiji did more than anyone else to advance the cause of Indian women. What social reform movement could not do in a century, the mass movement led by Gandhiji, sanctioned by him, did in months and years. It brought women out of their homes, out of their kitchens, onto the street. So I don't have time to go into more details, but I just to give you one last example, in 1930, in the civil disobedience movement, the most important parts of the mass campaign after the salt satyagraha, which was the boycott of foreign cloth, boycott of liquor and opium and all that, the boycott program, which was the active part of the program where mass involvement was the highest, where people used to go and picket the shops, picket the liquor dens, picket the stick, was handed over to women. That entire program was organized, run, staffed, everything by women. No man could enter that program. Do you know that? Who knows that? Do we talk about it? Do you know of any other example of any party in India handing over any parts of their national program or provincial program and say only women will do this? And Indian women, did it.
मुशर्रफ अली जी ने हाथ खड़ा किया है. मुशर्रफ अली अगर वो है मीटिंग में है तो पूछ लें सवाल. शायद है नहीं. हिमलता जी ने हाथ खड़ा किया. हिमलता जी ने हाथ, हिमलता माहेश्वर जी ने हाथ रेज किया है.
My throat is giving up.
हिंदी में बोल सकती हूँ?
जी जरूर.
बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद सबसे पहले सुभाष जी को कि एक बहुत महत्वपूर्ण लेक्चर का आयोजन किया, और दूसरा हार्दिक धन्यवाद मैडम मृदुला जी को कि उन्होंने एक इलस्ट्रेशन तैयार किया नेशनल और नेशनलिटी और नेशनलिज्म को लेकर के. तो बहुत एनरिच करने वाला आपका लेक्चर रहा मैडम. पर मेरा जो सवाल है वो ये है कि लगभग एक ही साल में 1920 में ही गांधी जी और अंबेडकर दोनों भारतीय राजनीति में उदित होते हैं, आते हैं, और जिस देश के संविधान की परिकल्पना डॉक्टर अंबेडकर जिस तरह से करते हैं, वी द पीपल कहते हैं, हम लोग जब कहते हैं, तो वो किस तरह के राष्ट्र का निर्माण करना चाह रहे थे, किस तरह की राष्ट्रीयता देखना चाह रहे थे? क्या डॉक्टर अंबेडकर आपको आपको मतलब आपके लेक्चर में मुझे सुनाई नहीं दिया, हो सकता है मैंने कहीं छोड़ दिया हो, पर डॉक्टर अंबेडकर की का क्या विजन था कि इस तरह का एक संविधान वो किसी एक देश के लिए निर्मित करते हैं? ये वाला हिस्सा आप इसको किस तरह से देखती हैं? बस इतना सा ही जानना है.
देखिए जहां तक मुझे नहीं समझ आया कि आप क्या कहना चाह रही थी, कि 1920 में दोनों आए, फिर अंबेडकर ने कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन ड्राफ्ट किया, मतलब सवाल वहां पे क्या है मुझे नहीं समझ आया उसमें. पर आपने जो सवाल पूछा कि अंबेडकर ने ये संविधान का निर्माण कैसे किया, जो कंसेप्शन था उसका, तो उसमें मेरा जवाब है कि देखिए अंबेडकर उसकी ड्राफ्टिंग कमिटी के चेयरमैन थे, उनका बहुत अहम रोल था. परंतु हमें ये जानना बहुत जरूरी है कि जो कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन बना 1950 में वो पूरी स्वतंत्रता संग्राम की जो लड़ाई थी उसका नतीजा था. वो किसी एक बड़े से बड़े लीडर भी, चाहे कितना बड़ा हो, चाहे वो गांधी हो, नेहरू हो, पटेल हो, तिलक हो, किसी एक की कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशन पे नहीं बना वो. मैं आपको एग्जाम्पल देती हूँ. 1895 में तिलक ने, लोकमान्य तिलक ने एक कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन ऑफ इंडिया बिल पेश किया, किसी असेंबली में नहीं, ऐसे ही पब्लिश किया पब्लिक के लिए, एक अपना विजन की जो हम बात कर रहे थे, विजन देने के लिए कि अभी क्या कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन ऑफ इंडिया होगी. उसमें एडल्ट सफरेज भी था 1895 में. तो ये जो आइडियाज हैं कि क्या होगा इंडिया का कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन, ये जब से हमारा स्वतंत्रता संग्राम शुरू हुआ लोग यही तो सोच रहे थे कि हम किसके लिए लड़ रहे हैं, जब जीतेंगे तो क्या देश बनाएंगे, संविधान तो उसका होगा ही ना. अंग्रेजों के नीचे तो एक संवैधानिक चीज तो रोज आती थी, कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल रिफॉर्म्स चलते रहते थे, वो पूछते रहते भी थे कि तुम बताओ अपने डिमांड क्या है. तो संविधान तो बनता ही जा रहा था, उसके एलिमेंट्स बनते जा रहे थे. ऑल पार्टीज कॉन्फ्रेंस, ऑल पार्टीज की जो मीटिंग थी 1928 में जिसमें मोतीलाल नेहरू की रिपोर्ट निकली, उसमें बहुत सारी फंडामेंटल चीजें आ गई. फंडामेंटल राइट्स जो थे पहली बारी उसमें मेंशन हो गए, और भी कई चीजें थी. एक कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन ऑफ इंडिया बिल, एनी बेसेंट वगैरह सबने मिलकर सेंट्रल असेंबली में इंट्रोड्यूस किया था 1925 में, उसमें बहुत सारी चीजें थी. और फिर सबसे इंपॉर्टेंट एक फॉर्मुलेशन आप देखें तो कराची रेजोल्यूशन 1931 का, जो गांधी जी ने खुद ड्राफ्ट किया, उसमें राइट टू एसोसिएशन, राइट टू ट्रेड यूनियन, विमेन्स राइट्स, नो डिस्क्रिमिनेशन ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ रेस, कास्ट, रिलीजन, ये सारा कुछ उसमें आ चुका था 1931 अप्रैल कराची रेजोल्यूशन पढ़ लीजिए. एक एसेंस में, एक शॉर्ट समरी फॉर्म में कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन इंडिया का क्या होगा उसमें आपको झलक मिल जाएगी, ट्रेलर मिल जाएगा. फिर 1937 से जवाहरलाल नेहरू ने तो अभियान शुरू कर दिया था, कॉन्स्टिट्यूएंट असेंबली बनाओ, कॉन्स्टिट्यूएंट असेंबली बनाओ। कैसे कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन बनेगा इंडिया का? कॉन्स्टिट्यूएंट असेंबली बनेगी, अंग्रेज नहीं देंगे हमको ये कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन। तो ये जो चीज है ना, ये मतलब एक मैं जो कह रही हूँ, ये कॉन्स्टिट्यूएंट असेंबली का बहुत रोल था फाइनल शेप देने के लिए, डिटेल के लिए, फ्रेजेस के लिए, वी द पीपल, यस वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट। पर दिस कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन एक डिस्टिलेशन था पूरे स्वतंत्रता संग्राम की जो अचीवमेंट थी, उसके जो आइडियाज थे, जो डायलॉग चला 80-90 साल, लीडरों में चला, लीडरों और लोगों के बीच में चला, लोगों के बीच में चला, और सबसे ज्यादा जो लोगों ने, एज दे से व्हाट पीपल वोटेड विद देयर फीट, जो जेल जाके लोगों ने बनाया। एक बारी जब महिलाएं जेल में जा रही हैं, तो क्या बाद में उनको कहेंगे कि सॉरी विमेन नहीं होंगी सफरेज का पार्ट, एडल्ट सफरेज नहीं होगा? क्या हम वेट करते 1970 तक स्विट्जरलैंड की तरह विमेन सफरेज के लिए? पता है आपको 1970 तक पूरा सफरेज नहीं मिला महिलाओं को स्विट्जरलैंड में, ब्रिटेन में जाके 1920 के आसपास मिला। तो इंडियन नेशनल मूवमेंट वॉज कमिटेड टू विमेन सफरेज, टू एडल्ट सफरेज। आप क्या गरीब लोगों को जेल भेज सकते थे, उनकी जान ले सकते थे, वो गोलियां खा सकते थे? तो 47 में क्या आप उनको ये कहते नहीं नहीं सोचेंगे कि आपको अभी फ्रेंचाइज देना है कि नहीं, अभी हम प्रॉपर्टी क्वालिफिकेशन के बेसिस पे देंगे, जैसे अंग्रेजों ने दिया हुआ था। अंग्रेजों ने क्या दिया हुआ था, 46 के जो इलेक्शन है उसमें 13% लोग सिर्फ वोट कर सकते थे। 1937 तक, तो 1937 में ये बदला, उसके पहले 3% लोगों को उन्होंने वोट दिए थे। तो ये तो फ्रीडम स्ट्रगल की वो थी, लोगों ने अपनी जिंदगी देके, अपने कुर्बानियां देके अपने लिए ये फ्रीडम सिक्योर करी। जो लॉ होते हैं ना, वो लॉ दिमाग से बन के नहीं निकल के आते, वो लड़ाई में से निकलते हैं। और मैं तो ये कहती हूँ, अभी तो मैं कहना चाह रही थी कि जो लोग ये सोचते हैं कि फ्रीडम स्ट्रगल की ट्रेडिशन मर गई है, वो ये किसान मूवमेंट कहाँ से पैदा हुआ, ये वही ट्रेडिशन जम के आ रही है फिर से। कहां से आ रहा है, क्या कौन सी पार्टी जाके उनको ला रही है, कौन उनको नॉन वायलेंस सिखा रही है? वही ट्रेडिशन आ रही है, वो मरी नहीं है। ऐसी बड़ी एक फ्रीडम स्ट्रगल, ऐसी एक मास मूवमेंट 100 साल लंबी तकरीबन, वो जल्दी से मरती भी नहीं है, वो दब सकती है, वो कहीं और से निकल के आ जाएगी। तो कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन भी जो है किसी एक का कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशन नहीं है, हिंदुस्तान की जनता का अपना अचीवमेंट है, इसीलिए उसमें वो वर्ड फ्रेज डाला गया वी द पीपल।
ये हेमलता जी, कुछ आप कुछ कहना चाह रही हैं? आप हाथ खड़ा किया, हाथ रेज किया है?
अच्छा
नहीं, ओके। ये देयर आर फ्यू मोर क्वेश्चंस, आर यू एबल टू, आर यू पोजीशन टू
थोड़ा छोटा छोटा कर लीजिए,
थोड़ा ये प्लीज। तो राजशेखर रामकृष्णन, our friend, wants to know, the talk was most instructive for me on the history of Indian, European Indian nationalism. Yeah, thanks so much for that. It seems to me that appeal to us versus others is much stronger than nationalism, working class consciousness, etc. Thus, significant numbers of poor whites in the US are willing to support Trump and Republicans, even though they don't help him, help them economically. This is my explanation for why Gandhian and Nehruvian nationalism haven't survived in the Hindi belt, while Bengali and Tamil nationalism are providing more significant resistance to the Hindutva project.
Yeah, you are not asking a question, you are making a comment. I think, yes, but I don't want to be, if I say yes, and then like poor Rahul Gandhi, who made a comment praising the Kerala people, he was immediately attacked for saying that you are denigrating UP. So I don't want to be accused of denigrating UP by praising Marathi or Bengali chauvinism, I mean, you know, nationalism. But it is an aspect, but I think these are still relatively, I think, simpler explanations, because, you know, one can always find examples to the contrary, you know, if you look hard enough. So you know, I think little more complex answers are perhaps needed. Yes, that's what I'm saying. This Kisan movement, see this same Western UP, this is why I said historians ka problem hai, that they can always think of something which counters there, which is why historians find it very difficult to theorize. But the moment you theorize, you find a contrary example. So very afraid of theory. Okay, abhi same Western UP is the land of khaps, is the land of communalism. If you go by that, you will say, what will happen? But now look what's happening before your eyes. So, you know, it's a question always of a combination of things. And how that combination will work, nobody can predict. That much I can tell you as a historian, you can't predict it. Because how that chemical balance and what it will produce, you know, because it is not a perfect one. You are not adding ingredients which are measured. So the result cannot be predicted also. What you can do is try to do enough of the good things to push it in a right direction. Ultimately, how it will happen, only people will do through their own genius.
We are taking the last question. There are many questions, but we are taking the last question now because Alok Tandon wants to know, do we not need a separate cultural organization to counter the RSS propaganda and put forward an alternative vision of nationalism with concrete content?
Definitely, I think not one, but you know, multiple cultural forums and organizations are needed to counter it. And I think, you know, you see the tradition of the left movement in India. You know, even when they were politically not such a big force, but that culturally they were so important. Even during the period of the war, IPTA was so important. You know, when conditions were so tough for Bengal famine, for example, they did such a lot. I mean, you look at till today, the tradition of music, of theater, if you see that period of the glorious period of IPTA, it attracted to it the best talent. It's very important. Similarly, in the, I think in the freedom struggle, if you see every region you go to, the importance of cultural forms. Swadeshi movement in Bengal, even today, if you attend a seminar in Bengal on Swadeshi movement, that seminar will not be complete without people singing songs of Swadeshi movement. Because it was a movement, first mass movement in Bengal of that kind. It gave rise to, you know, like a bursting of cultural expression. Painting, music, theater. Tagore is a product of that, a product, or he expressed himself very vigorously in that period, you know. So this is how things happen. I'm sure there'll be similar stories in Maharashtra and other places, you know. Punjab, Pagdi Sambhalo Jatta movement, for example. Why is it that movement is known by a song? Till today, the name of that movement is by a song. What movement? Pagdi Sambhalo Jatta. You know, oh peasant, defend your honor. Pagdi is a sign of honor. And that song became so powerful for that movement. No, it's still powerful, that song.
Thank you very much for this excellent presentation and the so it's really sorry for personally for me it's really the memory all those things that again we'll have to need to revisit all those things again and because the aaj mahol jaisa hai jisme bahut sari baatein bhool jati hain so it's many thanks for this presentation this presentation will be available on YouTube so you can anybody who wants it you can take that it will be there. So many thanks. We conclude now.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Bye.